Okay, I guess we could start. The topic I want to talk about in this lecture is one with which I've personally been rather strongly concerned over the last 30 years or so, namely how we actually treat the question of dissipation and or decoherence in the motion of a macroscopic, the quantum mechanics of a macroscopic variable. I have a feeling that today this has a tendency to look rather trivial, this whole topic. So I'd actually like to fill in a little bit of history, show that at least historically it's not been at all trivial. I'll talk a little more probably lecture 11, on the question of general motivation for doubting that quantum mechanics is necessarily applicable at the level of the macroscopic world. But I believe certainly that, at least in 1980, there was very considerable reason to question whether standard quantum mechanics, which worked so brilliantly at the level of individual atoms and molecules, would actually continue to work when extrapolated towards the macroscopic world. And it seemed that one rather good candidate for pushing it in this direction would be superconducting devices, in particular, as we'll see, flux qubits. Now, after essentially 35 years of research in this area, I think most people tend to take it for granted that quantum mechanics does in fact apply rather well to superconducting qubits. Certainly we have, so far, at least no evidence for any breakdown. But as I say, it was not obvious in 1980 that was going to be the case. Yeah. I'm not quite sure how one would sort of define or decide that question. I mean, you could only presumably do measurements on in the last resort on ensembles. Could you? Well, I mean, there's always been a line of thought which has claimed that the true description of individual systems was by some kind of hidden variable theory. But I think by 1980, very few people, certainly very few professional physicists, doubted that quantum mechanics was an excellent scheme for actually calculating the outcomes of experiments on individual particles. So I think that was probably not seriously questioned by most people, but I think there's a real question about whether this is still going to work when you push it up towards the level of Schrödinger's cat and related things.
So the EVA or precisely one specific experiment in 1980, the one by Andreas Bayer, were they physicists who thought that
Oh yes. Well, physicists. Ah, okay. I think there were. Yes. One rather famous person who committed himself in advance to the view that the Aspect result would not produce results in agreement with quantum mechanics was the philosopher Karl Popper. He actually came out and made that pretty explicit. No, there were also some physicists, I think, who seriously doubted it was going to. In fact, actually, an interesting example is Edwin James, because, as you know, James throughout the 50s, 60s, 70s, early 70s, was developing a semi-classical theory of radiation, in which you quantized the fermionic degrees of freedom, but not the electromagnetic field. So his description of the electromagnetic field was classical, and he's extremely ingenious. He managed to explain a very large number of phenomena which are usually thought of as essentially quantum mechanical in classical terms. You know, because there's one very standard example of this, which is the photoelectric effect. I mean, many of the more careless textbooks give the impression that the photoelectric, the existence of the photoelectric effect requires you to quantize the electromagnetic field. And in fact, of course, that's not the case. If you quantize the fermionic degrees of freedom, that'll do the trick. And James, but a whole lot of other things, more subtle cases in which James is able to show that this semi-classical picture would work. His last paper in this area, I think it was a talk to conference proceedings, and it puts forward, in the bulk of the paper, it puts forward his usual point of view on this, in defense of the semi-classical interpretation. And then, in a note added in proof, he says, I've just learned of this incredible experiment. It wasn't Aspect's experiment, in fact, it was the earlier one by Friedman and Clauser. I just learned of this incredible experiment by Friedman and Clauser on two-photon correlations. If this experimental result is right, my whole theory falls to the ground. And he never published any other more papers on the subject.
So I think you were scientifically honest compared to others as well.
Yes. Anyway, so as I say, there was real doubt that quantum mechanics was necessarily going to continue to work. And one, a few other people, when we approached this subject, we always had this in the back of our minds. And this, I think, tends to colour one's point of view a lot. Because if you simply take it for granted that quantum mechanics is going to work, then basically the question of how you treat decoherence and dissipation becomes a technical problem. And in some sense, you're happy with anything that's going to give you approximately results which approximately agree with the experiment. So if, on the other hand, you suspect that quantum mechanics is not going to continue to work, then you better be a lot more careful. For example, suppose we do an experiment which is designed to show, in some sense most of the relevant experiments are designed to show the effects of quantum superposition of macroscopically distinct states, like states of Schrodinger's cat, whatever. Suppose that we've actually engineered ourselves some situation in which we think we have a reasonable chance of seeing such a quantum superposition. Well, I mean, if it comes out according to our expectations, in other words, if we see the effects of the superposition, no one's going to worry about that. They'll say, yeah, well, of course, yes, what do you expect? If, on the other hand, we don't see the effects of superposition when we expect it to, what then? Well, one possible corollary, one possible conclusion is that this shows a failure of quantum mechanics at this level. But that's not the view that most of the community is going to take. Most of the community is going to say, well, the reason you didn't see the effects of superposition is because you've got some source of decoherence in your experiment. Obviously, these experiments are usually with large enough and complicated enough bodies that this is really quite plausible. So you have to be prepared ahead of time for that outcome. And you've got to try as best you can to put some kind of theoretical constraints on the possible effects of decoherence. In other words, as far as it's at all possible, you've got to put an upper limit on the amount of decoherence you can have. Now, in the early 80s, the upper limit which is accepted by, in some sense, most of the community, was incredibly weak. That is, people thought, perhaps I'm use the right word there, people, a lot of the community, thought that the moment you had any kind of a macroscopic body, the effects of decoherence are just going to kill you stone dead. And people used this this argument, what I call the electron on Sirius argument. You know, this is used in a lot of sort of qualitative discussions in quantum measurement literature. It basically said, well, look, you have this macroscopic body, it's got 10 to the 80th degrees of freedom floating around. The spacing between the energy levels and the coupling between energy levels, etc., are so incredibly fine that the motion of a single electron on a distant star is going to completely screw up. I mean, it seems, in retrospect, it may seem incredible that people actually believe that argument. and so you've got all these pompous papers in the formal quantum measurement literature assuring you solemnly that you're never going to be able to see the effects of quantum interference between any states which you would reasonably call macroscopically distinct. So that was the background, really, in around the early 80s, when we started seriously thinking about this kind of problem.
What would be the equivalent in 2014 of the electron on Sirius argument that people are using about quantum
No, I mean, I think, if anything, I think opinions swung completely in the opposite direction now. Yes, that...
You're not skeptical enough.
Okay. Yes, maybe. Yeah. Sometimes this is a case of this is a special case, a rather more generic question. How do we treat the effects of dissipation stroke decoherence in quantum mechanics? I'm essentially assuming here that there is some connection between these phenomena. In other words, very crudely, I'm assuming that if you have a body, a macroscopic body, which is subject to a certain amount of dissipation when you look at the classical motion, then it's likely to also be subject to a fair amount of decoherence in its quantum behavior. So the first question that arises then is, how do you suppose you have a system which you believe there is a sort of classical level of behavior, you've looked at its classical equation of motion and it seems to be well described by some kind of dissipative equation, for example, simple ohmic dissipation. By simple ohmic dissipation I mean a dissipation where the frictional force is linearly proportional to the velocity. Okay. So in electrical terms, that would be. Okay. Given that, how do you construct a decent quantum mechanical description of such a system? So this is a rather a generic problem. It goes beyond the context in which we formulate it. And there were, in the late 70s, say, there were various theoretical lines of approach to this problem. The first was a series of papers, which theoretical papers written throughout the 60s and 70s by these people, Decker, Yasue, Kanai, and various other people, which basically said, let's just look at the system by itself. We have this system whose classical motion is damped or dissipated. Let's just look at it by itself and let's try to modify something in the quantum mechanical description so as to describe the dissipation. We could try modifying the Lagrangian or the Hamiltonian or perhaps just modifying the form of the Schrodinger equation. And we'll do this in such a way as to incorporate energy loss and then hope that works in quantum mechanics. And the problem with that is, I think there are two problems, really. First of all, there was really no evidence that worked. The only case in which it was ever, in a sense, tested, that is, in which the theoretical predictions of this approach were compared with anything else which one could do in a different way were in the case of the simple damped harmonic oscillator. And even there, there were problems in the agreement. But in any case, I would not take any argument based on the simple harmonic oscillator seriously, because in some sense the simple harmonic oscillator is the most quasi-classical of all quantum mechanical systems. So the fact that things work for that doesn't prove that it's going to work elsewhere. But the second more fundamental objection to that line of argument, if you're except in very special circumstances, it seems, I think, rather intuitively obvious. But if you have a system which is interacting with some kind of complicated environment in such a way as to be able to dissipate energy into it, then it's at least extremely likely, if not certain, that it's going to be entangled with that environment. And therefore any description which works simply in terms of the system in its own right is suspicious ahead of time, I think. So I think nowadays these are of historical interest, mostly. Second line of approach was, I think, a much more plausible one. In certain cases, and we'll see, in fact, that simple Josephson junctions are a special case, you can actually write down a plausible description of your system from scratch in terms of microscopic variables. In some sense, we've done that. We've written down trial wave functions for trial quantum mechanical wave functions for a current biased, more precisely an isolated Josephson junction. And there are ways then of manipulating the relevant wave functions of the relevant equations in such a way that you do get out a required amount of dissipation. And this is actually done in the early 80s in a very nice paper by Ambergarkai, Ekin and Schoen in the case of a current biased junction. And I think for this particular system, that was a great reassurance, the fact that they could get out in this way, results that, as we'll see, can be got out by a more generic technique. But this only works if you have unambiguous knowledge of the physical origins of the dissipation you're talking about. In this case, the dissipation in question was just due to the normal electrons shunting the junction, and you have a fairly plausible microscopic description of these. However, in almost all, nowadays at least, in almost all practical Josephson devices, when you're operating in the quantum information regime, the normal electrons are an almost negligible source of dissipation, and any dissipation you have is much more likely to come from your leads and things like that. So you have to be prepared to deal with this kind of situation where you know from experimental classical regime you've got a certain amount of dissipation, you don't really know where it's coming from microscopically. So that's really the challenge, I think, in this game. So finally, we come to the kind of program that I've been myself a lot involved in, which I think has essentially become the established way of treating things. What you do is to, in some sense, give a phenomenological description, but give it explicitly of the system plus the environment. And what you do is to calculate in principle. What happened to my laser pointer? Has it disappeared somewhere? Thank you. Yes. What you do is to calculate, is to take some kind of phenomenological description, we'll see in detail what that is later, of the system plus the environment. And in principle, let's call the system plus its environment the universe. It's what we're the maximum we're interested in. We'll calculate, in principle, the quantum mechanical density matrix of the complete universe, S plus E. Then we'll trace out the environmental degrees of freedom to get the reduced density matrix of the system. In principle, you can do this in real time to get dynamics, and you can actually, well, okay, as we'll see, you can actually do that in such a way as to try to reproduce the classically allowed dynamics, that is, the dynamics in the classically allowed region, or alternatively, you can try to do it in imaginary time when you're dealing with tunneling problems. Now, so how are we going to set about constructing the appropriate phenomenological Hamiltonian of the system plus its environment? Well, in a few cases, we are confident enough about the nature of the environment to write down on sort of rather general a priori grounds some microscopic Hamiltonian. For example, that might be the case if you're dealing with nuclear spins in solids, let us say interacting with the phonons, then you think you do have a good enough microscopic picture that you can reliably write down some kind of a Hamiltonian for that. Again, if you're talking about defects tunneling in metals, probably in this case the most relevant environment is the conduction electrons. Again, you often think you know enough about it to write that down. But there are an awful lot of cases where that's not the case, in fact. You know that you have dissipation, you don't know where it's coming from. So really, the really urgent question in this context is to what extent can we use the behaviour in the classically allowed, the classical dynamics, to model the environment and the interaction between the system and its environment with sufficient confidence that we can make a reliable calculation of what quantum mechanics is going to produce. Remember here that it's almost certain that you're not going to be able to, in almost all these cases, with very few exceptions, it's almost certain you're not going to be able ever to determine the exact Hamiltonian of your system plus its environment. The real question is, what features of the environment is it which are going to be crucial to the behaviour of the system, and can we find out enough about those features from the classical dynamics? And rather satisfyingly, the answer which was evolved during the 1980s and subsequently is it looks like we can. Now we have to be careful here. I think we're all going to be fairly happy with this state of affairs so long as quantum mechanics continues to work. Okay. The moment that it looks as if quantum mechanics might be failing, then I think people are going to come back and look at all the holes in this argument and a great deal more attention. But for the moment, at least, as I say, it does look like quantum mechanics is working at the level of flux qubits and similar things. So, as I say, people have been reasonably happy about it. Okay, so how does this work? There's a fundamental assumption involved here, namely that any individual degree of freedom of the environment is only weakly perturbed by its interaction with the system. That allows us then, we'll see how in detail in a moment, but what that does is to allow us to model the environment by a bath of simple harmonic oscillators and to model recoupling to the environment by some interaction with the simple coordinate interaction. This is something which has actually been done quite long ago by Feynman and Verman, in fact. They more or less just wrote this down and said, well, this seems to be a plausible way of doing it. In the early 80s, we tried to make that a lot more precise and to try to justify that a lot better. But just to show you, to indicate why this is likely to be a successful technique, just think for a moment about standard textbook atomic physics. Now, in a standard textbook on atomic physics, you get all sorts of words occurring, like oscillator strengths and so forth. We know now, today, we know, this refers, oscillator strengths refers to the behaviour of an atom interacting with an electromagnetic field. today we know for sure that the atom has nothing to do with a set of harmonic oscillators. But in the 19th century, in the late 19th century, people didn't know anything much about the structure of the atom, and they tentatively assumed that it's going to be, it's going to behave as if it were composed of a, or as if there were a whole set of harmonic oscillators there. Okay? And they used that model to calculate some of the spectral properties when you had interaction with radiation and so forth, and lo and behold, those results still hold, and they appear in modern textbooks. Why? Very simple reason. They didn't have lasers in the late 19th century. And because they didn't have lasers, they had to use natural light sources. And when a light wave of this kind of strength that you can get out of typical natural sources, like a, well, I say natural source, I mean a sodium arc or something like that, not lasers, the sort of strengths of a field that you get out of that are such that any one degree of freedom in any one atom is only very weakly excited. Now that does not mean that the light can't get fully absorbed. You may easily have a situation where you've got a light beam, you shine it on a gas, and it gets completely absorbed by the gas. But if you just ask exactly how far is any one electron in any one atom excited, the answer is very, very little. And as a result, you can, they didn't know this, of course, but you can in fact, use an oscillator Bof description of your atoms, I suppose. One caution, however, the oscillator Bof model, I believe, can be legitimately used in a large number of physically relevant cases, but it's not, can't always be used, and in particular, it can't be used if there are you do have single degrees of freedom of your environment which are strongly perturbed. And a typical example of this, which has become rather important in recent years, is if I have a current biased junction and I'm trying to operate it as a qubit, and we'll come to that in detail in the next lecture. If I'm trying to operate this so-called phase qubit, a current biased Josephson junction, then it turns out that an important source of dissipation appears to be some kind of two-level systems which are embedded in the junction. We don't know exactly what they are, but plausibly they might be single electrons which can be trapped at one of two neighbouring sites and can hop between those sites. In any case, the point is that I think one can now say it's an experimental fact, this is the work of John Martinez and his group principally, that the interaction of your principal degree of freedom, in this case the phase variable of the Josephson junction, with these two-level systems can be rather strong. It can be so strong that basically there's a probability or half that, or you can form it in some sense a superposition state with equal weight of the two states of your junction. So that's no longer a weak coupling situation. So you have to be careful about that. And there have been there's been some literature on this kind of situation. In particular, my former student Philip Stamp has produced a model of what he calls a spin bath, which is essentially a set of two-level systems interacting with the system. And he claims that this gives qualitatively different results from the oscillator bath, and that in particular the relationship which we're going to explore between dissipation and decoherence is qualitatively quite different. I have to say I'm sceptical of that claim. I don't think it's been proved, and I've got a student working on it right now, and we'll see whether that comes out or not. But there's a lot of these claims around, and you should be aware of them. We do have an oscillator bath. One of the great advantages is that almost uniquely, harmonic oscillators are one system where you can solve the equations of motion exactly, at least for certain cases of forced motion and so forth. That's a sort of textbook problem. What this means is that you can solve the equations of motion, whether you're talking as classical or quantum mechanical, for your oscillators, integrate them out of the problem completely, and obtain an effective description of the system in its own right. So you essentially, by doing that, we achieve what these phenomenological approaches of the 50s and 60s were trying to do, but we've now been able to justify it much more rigorously. Okay, now we come to this rather messy question of the justification of the oscillator bath model. And I'm not going to subject you to the full gory details of this. I have a number of lengthy papers on this subject, and if anyone you're interested in detail, you can go and read these. But let me try to give you the main essentials here. Suppose we have a system S, which is described by some coordinate Q. For example, it might be the trapped flux in a flux qubit. The conjugate momentum P, and the system by itself, if you regard it as isolated, has some Hamiltonian, which is a function of those variables. We've seen some examples of that. You've now got a general environment, E, whose nature you may not know in detail. It's got a set of coordinates, which we'll call xi, and there are some canonically conjugate momenta P sub xi. There's a Hamiltonian, H sub E, and the eigenfunctions of the environment by itself, such as this holds. So remember, for the moment, we haven't made any assumptions about the environment. It's just very generic. Then we've got some system environment interaction, which is Hermitian, appropriately Hermitian. And we can write down the matrix elements of that with respect to the environment wave functions here. So this is just a definition here. Again, this is Hermitian operator. So the crucial assumption now is that for all the relevant values of P and Q, and crudely speaking, relevant means the kind of values that are going to occur with appreciable probability in either the classical or the quantum mechanical description. Well, all relevant values of those the system variables, P and Q, this quantity, the ratio of the matrix element here to the environment excitation energy, is small compared to 1. So crudely, in words, crudely speaking, that means that starting from the, as a matter of fact, this is probably a little too general. I've got an N, I don't know if you can read this, I'm sorry. There's an NM here. Perhaps if we turn the lights down, don't you think it'd be a good idea?
The next step is turning them off.
Okay. Can people read this? I don't know. Okay, well, fine. Sorry, it's my eyes. Really bad. okay, so, well, anyway, this may be a little too unnecessary strong assumption, but let's make this assumption here that the ratio of this exciting matrix element to the bare excitation energy is always small compared to 1. So, crudely speaking, any 1 degree of freedom of the environment is only weakly excited. Then, if we assume that the environment starts in its ground state, the probability of a process which involves n factors of v will be, the amplitude will be epsilon to the n, the probability will be epsilon to the 2n. So if we neglect terms of order epsilon cubed and higher, then the only relevant matrix elements are the ones between the ground state of the environment and various excited states n. And for reasons of convenience, I'll now make a slight change of notation. I'll call the environment state J rather than N. So now let's define operators XJ and PJ in the space of these environment wave functions by these suspiciously familiar looking matrix elements here, okay? Where omega j is just the excitation frequency corresponding to the jth excited state. And for the moment, we'll set all other matrix elements of these operators equal to 0. So this is sort of trivial, really, what we're doing. We've simply taken the two, for any particular degree of freedom n, we've simply taken the state n and the state 0, and we're going to regard these as the two lowest states of a simple harmonic oscillator. So we're now going to add for each J an infinite set of fictitious oscillator levels. These never in fact really come into the answer, but it's just convenient to do this. We'll call these N sub J, standard oscillator levels with energies h bar, nh bar, omega j, etc. If we do that, the original levels of the environment are just trivially given by this. This is the ground state. The first excited state corresponding to excitation of degree of freedom j is just the first oscillator, corresponding oscillator state. All the rest of the oscillators in the ground state. Now we're just going to extend the operators x and j into the fictitious space by just defining their matrix elements in the standard way. And now we construct an effective Hamiltonian for the environment, which is, well, just our good old set of harmonic oscillators. And finally, now this is the bit where things do become more sticky. A general representation of the system-environment interaction under these conditions can now be written in this form. So you've got coupling to the oscillator coordinates, coupling to their momenta, and in general these fj and pj, gj's can be arbitrary functions of p and q. So fj is given by the real part of the original interaction and gj by the imaginary part. So in some sense this really is rather trivial. All we've done is just to notice that in this limit we can formally write the relevant parts of the environment Hamiltonian and the relevant parts of the interaction in this standard harmonic oscillator form. Well, they're fictitious because they don't, in general, correspond to the real excited states of the environment. I mean, the real excited states of the environment are horribly complicated, in general, and can't, except in special cases, can't be mapped, or can't necessarily be mapped into a simple harmonic oscillator form. But you're not never going to have to worry about these high excited states. That's the crucial point. Well, so this is just a formal construction. I mean, these states don't really correspond to anything in real life. But since they're not, in any case, going to be involved in the calculation of the response functions and so forth, it doesn't matter. One could get away without ever explicitly introducing the oscillators. It's just that, you know, we're used to, people like harmonic oscillators, they're used to thinking in these terms. The original, the different states n or now j of the environment, those are definitely mutually orthogonal since they're different eigenstates of the environment Hamiltonian. The oscillators, yes, by construction, the first excited state of oscillator j is different, is orthogonal to that of oscillator j prime, and moreover, the second excited state here. Of J is orthogonal to the first excited state.
So you apparently know nothing but do some sort of basis change of all the excited states of the environment at least.
You've basically, what you've really done is to ignore, is to say, I don't care about the detailed nature of the higher excited states.
Okay.
So as I say, we could have got away without using this language at all. We could have worked explicitly in terms of just Vn0 and so forth all the way. But as I say, it's just that we have a whole set of sort of formal tricks that we're used to doing with oscillators, so it's nice to be able to use this language. Any 1 degree of, yeah, let me just re-emphasize this point though. The environment as a whole is not necessarily weakly perturbed, and certainly its effect on the system is not weak in general. But any 1 degree of freedom of the environment is weakly perturbed.
By extension, the environment itself
could be perturbed. Perhaps that's a matter of language. Yes, you could say that if you like, but then you have to add that the effect of this weak perturbation of the system is strong. Yeah. It gets some amplitude for the excited states, but it's small. Yes.
Yes.
environment, harmonic oscillators as two-level systems.
Yeah.
Because you don't reach the saturation.
Well, exactly. I mean, as long as we could go through exactly the same formal construction, treating the environment as a whole set of two-level systems, and it wouldn't matter. But it's just that there are all these sort of standard tricks with harmonic oscillators that we're used to. Now, I mean, I think it is an important question. It's one which Philip Stamp has legitimately raised, whether when you get when you go beyond this weak coupling, this extreme weak coupling situation, well, I say perhaps weak coupling is the wrong word, weak perturbation of any one degree of freedom. Once you go beyond that situation, whether the construction in terms of two-level systems will give you qualitatively different results from one in terms of oscillators. I don't believe it personally that it's likely to be qualitatively different, but as I say, that's still, I think, somewhat in the air. Okay, now, we still have to deal. This is the where it really gets a bit messy and tricky, and I certainly don't want to subject you to the agony of going through all the canonical transformations and so forth that one needs to go through, but we have to decide what we're going to take F and G to be. And now there is one rather a delicate point that caused a lot of confusion in the early days of the subject. Suppose that you take some specific form of F and G. A very simple case, which we'll come back to later, is one in which you simply take Fj of P and Q to be simply equal to Q, the coordinate of the system, and G to be zero. Okay, that's a very standard form of coordinate coupling. You want to use that and produce. Now remember that one of the a severe constraint on this whole description is it's got to give you the right classical equations of motion. That is the right equations of motion as you verified them experimentally in the classically accessible regime or the classical limit. Now, if you just, for example, use a simple form like say this, it will indeed produce dissipation for you, and we'll see in a minute how. However, after you've integrated out the xj's, it'll also give you an extra reactive term in your effective potential. So, in fact, specifically, if you use this form of coupling, then the additional term in the effective potential on the system after you've integrated out the oscillators is given by this expression here. And crudely speaking, you can see why this is, because if I've got, I'll come back to this diagram later, but suppose I've got, I think of the system in a multidimensional space in which this axis is Q and this represents a typical value of xj up here. Initially, the system is moving in some kind of potential which is decoupled, that is, the potential is for xj equals zero, the potential is just like so, and then we just add on bits. I'm trying to make that a bit more precise. The potential is actually just the sum of a term involving q and a term involving xj. Yeah. So in this picture, you'd have a sort of symmetry around this axis here. Now, if I put on a coupling of the form in the second line there, you see, what that's going to do is to shift the potential over. So, and it means in particular that for a given value of q, I can get to a lower potential by going to a finite value of xj. Okay? So, and now when I say, okay, I actually want in some sense the best value of xj, the value which will give me the lowest potential, then of course my potential is actually lowered. And that caused an enormous amount of confusion in the very early days of the subject. It turns out if you do things properly, you never have to explicitly worry about this point. But if you do want to worry about it, then what you can do is to simply cancel it by adding to the original system Hamiltonian the appropriate counter terms. So then as a result of doing that operation, you've got this term which is independent of the coordinates of the oscillator bath, but it depends on its parameters. So it's usually convenient to write out explicitly such a term, call it phi of P and Q. Okay. So you don't need to do that. There are ways of doing any specific problem which get you around this step, but it's sometimes useful to do it. So finally, the complete effective Hamiltonian of the universe, that is the system plus its environment, is given by a term involving just the system, a term involving the environment, describing it as a set of harmonic oscillators, and a system-environment interaction, and a counterterm, possibly a counterterm. And the oscillator environment is just this, simple harmonic oscillators. The system environment, Hamiltonian, is this. So the claim is then that to the extent that double excitation of any one degree of freedom of the environment E is negligible, or in other words, that any one degree of freedom is weakly perturbed, then this expression will give a complete account of the effect of the environment on the system. And again, I emphasise, probably the third time, this condition is much weaker than the condition of weak damping. So again, going back to the analogy with 19th century atomic physics, you can perfectly well have a situation where your light beam is totally absorbed in the gas, and yet because any one degree, any one electronic state in any one atom is only weakly perturbed, you can get away with the harmonic oscillator description, and that's why they could do that. Okay, but let me just go on for one moment more and then just stop for any possible questions. There is a quite useful generalization. Again, this is done in rather gory detail in our long paper in Annals of Physics in 1983. There may well be cases in which, in fact, formally the condition of perturbation of any one degree of freedom is not satisfied. If you take the example, say you have a cup of coffee and you stick a spoon in it and you start stirring the coffee, it's clear that any one molecule of the coffee is likely to be quite strongly perturbed. Okay? But nevertheless, there may be circumstances in which you can get away with what's usually called a Born-Oppenheimer description. In other words, you treat essentially the relevant environmental degrees of freedom as fast compared to the motion of your macroscopic variable, and you write down a Hamiltonian. This is actually generic, in fact. You can always do this. It turns out you can always cast your Hamiltonian in this form, where K, this operator K of Q, is a rather nasty expression involving matrix elements in the Born-Oppenheimer basis. So forth, which I say that this is all done in gory detail in one of the appendices to this paper here, but so K is an operator on the states of the environment, which is parametrically dependent on Q. So K is sort of like a magnetic vector potential, the way it comes in. This is just of the general form that we wrote down. You can easily identify the terms, and so you can follow through the arguments again if in the Born-Oppenheimer representation, as it were, any one degree of freedom is weakly perturbed, then you can still get away with an oscillator bath model. So the mere fact in some sense, at the microscopic level, one degree of freedom sometimes may be strongly perturbed, may not matter. If that degree of freedom is basically fast enough that it will respond adiabatically, a la Born-Oppenheimer, to the motion of the principal variable. Okay, let me just stop at the moment, just ask if there are any questions or comments.
So what is the bath made of?
That depends. I mean, in real life, that will depend on the particular system you're talking about. For example, if you were talking, let's consider, for example, a flux qubit. What are the physically the likely sources of decoherence there? Well, in principle you have the normal electrons, but as we've seen, at sort of temperatures which are usually relevant for quantum information processing, there essentially are no normal electrons, so you can forget about those. There's the black body radiation field. That's certainly an important potential source of decoherence. There's the nuclear spins. There's some effect of the phonons. It turns out to be rather weak, but it's there, etc. So, you know, there are maybe half a dozen different physical mechanisms of dissipation. So the nice point about the oscillator bath is that once you've persuaded yourself, you don't have to worry. All you have to do, what we are going to have to do, and we'll just come to that in a moment, is to make quite sure that we've chosen the parameters of our model so as to correctly produce the classical equations of motion. But once you've done that, you'll have...
And what I got from your sort of explanation of not being able to count phase is kind of a decoherence, very weak decoherence effect where the environment keeps track of the phase. Is that somehow related?
Yes, I mean, one possible language in which you can try to describe the decoherence at the quantum mechanical level by your environment, of course, is that in some sense the environment is continually coming in and trying to observe the value of the phase or the flux or whatever it is you're talking about, and the more effectively it does it, the more you decohere the quantum mechanical motion. Yep. Oh, 2π. That's a tricky point, actually. There are papers in the literature, actually these are by my former colleagues and collaborators at Illinois in the mid-80s. There are papers in the literature which look explicitly at the effect of the ohmic dissipation due to normal quasar particles on the 2π periodicity. And they come out with the conclusion that if you have sufficiently strong ohmic dissipation, then you've effectively decohered, as it were. Well, no, I think decohered is probably the wrong word. You've destroyed the equivalence between 0 and 2π. I have to say that the more I think about that conclusion, the more it worries me, because if you really destroyed the equivalence between 0 and 2π, it seems to me that you've no obvious basis for the quantization of the conjugate variable. You see, imagine that we're talking about a real angle, say, in the case of a pendulum. What is it that justifies the statement that the angular momentum of the pendulum is quantized? Well, presumably it's the fact that your wave function has got to come back to itself at 2π. If you've destroyed that, or argued that it's been destroyed by the dissipation in the system, say the friction in the pendulum spindle, then at first sight at least, it looks as if you've destroyed that result, which is slightly worrying. So I've sort of vaguely come to the conclusion that not everything was in fact sorted out in this problem in the 80s, and one might need to go back to it. But very luckily it turns out that I think right now at least, unless we're sort of interested explicitly in mesoscopic phenomena which don't directly have to do with quantum information, if we were interested in that, we might have to worry rather seriously about this point. But if we're interested in the use of Josephson devices as qubits, then crudely speaking, I think we can legitimately take the view that either we're dealing with flux qubits, where the flux variable really is not ambiguous, it doesn't have this 2π ambiguity, or alternatively we're dealing with current bias junction. If we're dealing with a current bias junction, then as we'll see in the next lecture, we're really interested only in the weakly bound metastable states, and once the system has got out of the metastable well, it can run away and we're not interested in it anymore. So by the time it gets down to 2π, as it were, we've forgotten about it. But as I say, I think there probably is a little more to be sorted out than has been sorted out so far.
When you speak of dissipation, do we have to distinguish dissipation that acts on particles and on phase?
Excuse me?
When we have dissipation,
yes.
Can we say we have particle fluctuations? Or?
Well, sure. Physically, any particular source of decoherence in your environment is liable to couple to one, possibly more than one, but primary to one variable of your system. So, for example, suppose I have a flux qubit. Then the principal variable is the flux, and that is going to be, for example, sensitive to fluctuations in the blackbody radiation field, over the 60 hertz background. On the other hand, if I've got a Cooper pair box, then the most likely source of decoherence is going to be the fluctuations in the charges, the background charges surrounding it. And so in any particular kind of decohering mechanism, you can usually identify one variable, which may or may not be the variable you've specified as it were the coordinate, which we'll couple to.
So my point is, if you have a large fluctuation in N, it can be desirable, right?
Well, yeah, provided it's controlled. Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
No. So because of this, phase and number are continuous.
Right. Yes. So that's right. So if you want to operate as you typically do in the case of a flux qubit, you want to operate in what you might call the near classical regime of the flux. That is, you want to treat the flux as nearly a classical variable, but not quite. As it were. Then you want a strong fluctuation in the conjugate variable, the charge across the capacitor. Well, it can be desirable so long as, in some sense, as long as the fluctuations are controlled by the system itself and not by some interaction with a bit of an environment you'd rather was not there. So, for example, I mean, if I was talking about a flux qubit, then, as I say, the variable conjugate to the trapped flux is the charge across the capacitor, the plates of the capacitor formed by the junction. Now, that charge is certainly going to have interactions with background charges, and that's not necessarily going to be helpful. As a matter of fact, whether it's helpful or not depends on what aspect I want to focus on, but generally speaking, in the context of quantum information, it's not helpful. I mean, generally speaking, it'll tend to degrade the performance. Okay, so... So how are we going to? Let me just ask if there are any more questions before I go on, because this is a sort of next step in the argument we have to go to now. How are we actually going to obtain these quantities? I should say incidentally that not all of these. I put these variables in for historical reasons, because this is what we. This is the language we used in the original papers. In fact, there's a certain amount of superfluity here. You can actually absorb, for example, the masses into the coupling constants in such a way you don't have to write out the masses explicitly, but as I say, I'm just doing it for historical reasons. But we certainly do have to determine these quantities. And a possible answer, in fact, the answer that's really become accepted is that we should demand that in the limit where the system can be treated classically, then after we've integrated out the oscillators, the Hamiltonian, which I wrote down back for a moment, Hamiltonian here, it should give the experimentally observed classical equation of motion of S, including any displacement terms. Now, unfortunately, it's not clear that this constraint is, in the most general case, is enough to determine the parameters of H sufficiently uniquely to enable us to a derivation of definitive results in quantum mechanics. It would be very nice if it were, and that would, in some sense, close a number of loopholes, but one can give specific examples to show that, in general, it may not be so. However, we often have a rather favourable common case, and that is when, as observed in the classical equation of motion, the elements which are shunting our system, thinking now in electric terms, the elements which are shunting our system are in fact linear elements. In other words, if we can write an equation of motion of the following form, some linear operator k acting on the principal variable is equal to minus dv by dq. So, okay, let's just take the trivial case. In the case where we simply have an undamped Newtonian particle, of course k would just be d squared by dt squared. If I've got a damped, a linear damping, then I'm going to get an extra term with eta times dq by dt, etc. So these are standard linear terms. And very generally speaking, it turns out that under the conditions under which we operate Jesus injunctions in the quantum information context, generally speaking, the elements which shunt the junction are classically linear. That is, the classical equation of motion does appear to be represented in this form. Well, that means, in turn, that you can take the Fourier transforms and express everything in terms of k of omega. And if you work in sort of standard electrical language, the resultant circuit simply has your junction shunted by some element k of omega, and in terms of standard electrical terminology, k is simply I omega times the admittance shunting your junction. Remember, though, that when I use this language, then in general k does have, as it were, a mass term in it, that is, which in the case of a electrical circuit would be the capacitance term. Yeah. One thing that is very important, it turns out, is that I said k is an arbitrary linear operator, but we must impose the standard conditions of causality. That is, we cannot have an effect preceding its cause, and that then has implications for the analytic structure of k of omega in the complex plane, which we're going to use. Now, so far so good. But all we've said so far is that we believe that the classical equation of motion can be represented in a model in which we simply shunted the system by a linear, by various linear elements. Unfortunately, that's not enough to guarantee that the interaction term is of this simple linear form. You might think it's very natural that it would be, but you can construct counterexamples where you have more complicated forms than this, and it can still give you a classical equation of motion which is represented in a simple linear form. That's a pity, and I wish I knew how to get rid of that that complication, but as of now we don't. However, let's make that assumption. Again, in certain cases, it may be possible to give physical arguments as to the fact, although we may not know in detail the form of the interaction with the dissipative environment, we may nevertheless be able to argue that it is indeed linear in this kind of way. That would be the case, for example, in certain kinds of real electrical circuits where, for example, we know that, or we have very strong reason to suspect that any interaction of, let us say, the electrical current must be linear in the current itself. So let's make that assumption. And then it turns out we have to, well, at least it's convenient, I should say. I don't think it may not be necessary, but it's convenient to make two other assumptions. One is that both the environment Hamiltonian and the system environment interaction are time reversal invariant. We don't necessarily have to assume that the system Hamiltonian is. It might not be. And for example, in the case of a flux qubit, it usually isn't. So so we better allow for that. And then it turns out, given this, there's then a rather tedious set of canonical transformations which we can carry out, which will enable us to reduce our original Hamiltonian, which remember was had this form here, the interaction had that form here. We can reduce it to a simpler form, which is this. Now we've got, here's our system as part of the Hamiltonian, oscillator bath, and now what we have is a simple linear coupling to the coordinates of our oscillators, plus a counter term here. And so that counter term is necessary if we don't want to introduce unwanted reactive effects, which are not physically there. Again, you can actually, in practical cases, you can demonstrate explicitly that counter term has to be there. Here's a typical example. Suppose I have a simple LC circuit, nothing fancy, and I'm going to shunt it with a simple linear resistor. So I want to write down an effective Hamiltonian which will describe this situation. Now, one thing I know for sure is that putting that resistor in parallel with the LC circuit is going to introduce some dissipation, but it's not going to reduce, if the resistor is weak, it's not going to introduce a huge renormalization. I mean, there will be a small renormalization proportional to the dissipation squared, but there won't be a huge renormalization of the frequency of my circuit. And so I know a priori that any model I write down has to have that property. And if you actually go through the microscopics, we do see one of the appendices to our long paper. If you go through the microscopics, it turns out that indeed you do get this counter term coming in automatically. So that's the general structure. Now we write down the classical equation of motion. Because the equations of motion of the xj are simple, xj is simple as a linearly driven harmonic oscillator. So we can actually solve for the xj's in terms of q and insert those back into the equation of motion of q. And in Fourier transform form, sure enough, the result comes out to be this here. And this quantity, k of omega now, has got to be the quantity which we saw in the experimental classical equation of motion. K of omega, apart from some trivial point, is uniquely determined by the Kronos-Kronig relation by its imaginary part. So this equation of motion then uniquely determines the imaginary part of this quantity here, which we'll call J of omega. This is a crucial quantity in this whole theory. J of omega is, in terms of the parameters of this model, it's this combination here. It involves the sum of the coupling constants. You can get rid of the m's if you need to, but it's more convenient to keep them in. And then delta omega minus omega j. This, as I say, this is a fundamental quantity in the whole theory of dissipative quantum mechanics. It's what we can call a coupling spectral density. It involves the density of states of my environment and also the strength of the coupling to them. For example, just to give a simple example, to reproduce simple ohmic dissipation, that is an equation of motion of this form here, it's enough to take J of omega to be simply linear in omega, so eta, the friction coefficient, times omega. And in other more complicated cases, you can make similar correspondence. Now, the real payoff is that also in the quantum mechanical calculations, whether you're talking about tunneling, decoherence, or whatever, lo and behold, it turns out that once you eliminate the environmental degrees of freedom, the xj's, and the result is an expression which contains only j of omega. Therefore, both classically and quantum mechanically, within this, this scheme of things, the effect of the environment on the system is completely determined by J of omega. It's completely encapsulated in J of omega. So at the end of the day, we come out with the following rather pleasant conclusion. If the assumptions we made are valid, then you can indeed reliably infer the effects of the environment on the quantum behaviour of the system from its effects on the classical motion. And that's really, the punchline, the payoff here. One immediate qualitative consequence of this is that if for all relevant frequencies, including zero, there's no dissipation, omega goes to zero, there's no dissipation in the classical motion, then you would expect that there's no decoherence due to the environment, no true decoherence due to the environment. Now, a caution at this point. I think, as I say, this is the general scheme which has been developed over the last 30 years to deal with the whole question of dissipation in the quantum mechanics of a macroscopic variable. But one should be aware that there are loopholes in it. As I said, no one's going to worry too much probably about these loopholes as long as quantum mechanics continues to work. But the moment anything appears to be going wrong, then I think the skeptics are going to come back and insist that we do plug some of these loopholes, and rightly so. One of the things in the literature, you'll find that although in our original work, and this applies also, I guess, to Feynman and Vernon, so far as they did it implicitly. In our original work, we explicitly assumed that we're working at zero temperature, and therefore the environment was starting in its ground state. As far as I know, there's never been any proper generalization to the case where the environment starts at finite temperature. So, but people nevertheless still continue to use this formalism. So, I think one does have to be careful about that. It's sort of plausible that it's going to continue to work, but I don't think one can swear to it. Again, the conditions, to give you an example, under what conditions can you really say you're sure that the single environment degree of freedom is not going to be strongly perturbed? Here, an example would be a very degenerate Fermi gas, say. You see, if you, when you're storing a very degenerate, imagine you have a very degenerate Fermi gas of electrons, say, and you're stirring it with some kind of, I don't know, STM tip or something like that, then the odds are that you actually are saturating many of the transitions quite appreciably there. So it's not obvious that this is going to continue to work, and you may have to do something more general. So. But luckily, again, it turns out that for many of the practical conditions under which we get a... we would like to use these systems for quantum information purposes, it looks like it's plausible that the conditions are such that this does work. So, and certainly it's been very widely used in literature. Okay, I don't know if I should stop here or start just do the final. I have got two more slides for this talk, which are on, why don't I just try briefly to go through this, if necessary, and come back to this at the beginning of next time. The first application which we made of this this formalism was to the question of the effect of dissipation on quantum tunneling. So imagine you have a system which is trying to tunnel out of a metastable well. And now what we're going to do is to compare two situations. And a crucial point to notice is that we're assuming that the potential is the same in these two situations. But the equation of motion in the first case is just this, a simple Newtonian equation of motion. Here we've got this extra damping term. Mm-hmm. Question, how does the tunneling rate in case B compare with that in case A? Now, we have a simple but actually slightly deceptively simple argument in this case. It turns out this argument only works because ohmic dissipation of this is rather special in the sense that when you plug it into a Kramers-Kronig relation, it doesn't give you any mass renormalization. Just about any more complicated form of dissipation will give you some mass renormalization, and that complicates matters, but luckily for this case it doesn't. So, okay, imagine, this is the diagram I was trying to draw over here, unsuccessfully. Here are the contours of constant energy in the plane of Q and one of the xj here. So in the absence of dissipation, you don't have any of the, you don't have the system environment coupling. So your contours are nicely symmetric in this way here. And if this is the form of your potential, then to get out, you've got to go across this saddle point here. The saddle point is a distance, Q0, from the origin, and it has a height of some V0 here. Now, what happens when you introduce dissipation? Well, we've said you had to introduce this linear coordinate-coordinate coupling in your Hamiltonian. So what that does, effectively and intuitively, is to shift your potential away, like so, but at this point it's crucial to remember that you did have to put in that counter term. And the counter term is just such that it turns out that it means that at any particular value of Q, the minimum value of Q is exactly the same as it was originally. In other words, in particular, the saddle point here occurs at exactly the same height as it did originally. And moreover, at the same value of Q, well, it's been shifted off the axis here. So so both the value of Q at which the saddle point occurs and the height of the saddle point are the same in the two cases. This has the interesting consequence that the exponent in the standard classical Gibbs-Arrhenius case which remember is just V0 over KT, that's completely insensitive to dissipation. And that's a well-known result in Cramer's theory. Okay? In Cramer's theory, the Gibbs-Arrhenius exponent is completely insensitive to the presence or absence of dissipation. The only way that comes in is through the prefactor. In quantum mechanics, on the other hand, you've got a WKB integral square root of V dS, where dS is the path to the center point. Now you see the length of the path has now been increased because by Pythagoras' theorem, as it were. You've not gone from here to here, you've gone from here to here. So you've got a longer path length. And so you would expect then that in the dissipative case, the WKB exponent increases, so the tunneling rate goes down. And we can actually try to do a more detailed calculation. This is a calculation I did with my student Amir Caldera back in 1981. And the technique we used was the instanton technique. It's more or less standard for this kind of calculation, but now taking into account the oscillators. And we found that indeed the WKB exponent is increased, and in fact the increase is a constant, which is weakly dependent on the degree of damping, times eta Q0 squared over H bar. And so the qualitative conclusion that comes out of that is that ohmic dissipation of the simple ohmic form will always suppress quantum tunneling out of the metastable well. And you can actually try to estimate quantitatively how much it will suppress it. And that result was actually verified pretty quantitatively by John Clark and his group a few years later. Now, you do need to make this caution that in the non-ohmic case, you have to be rather careful because, as I said, in general, you'll find that one effect of putting in this coupling to the environment is going to give you mass renormalizations and so forth, and the mass does enter the WKB exponent. So depending on the circumstances, it could go either way. And there are cases, in fact, in which dissipation which is not of the simple ohmic form can actually increase the tunneling rate. However, generally, I think one can usually take the view that for most practical purposes, when you're talking about superconducting devices operated in a quantum information context, you take the simple point of view. Just take your shunting admittance and expand it as in powers of omega. The lowest non-trivial term is always going to be the term proportional to omega, right, in linear term. So that means that if there's any ohmic coefficient there, then at least at low frequencies, that's always going to be the dominant thing. So. And you're not usually very likely to have to worry about terms in omega cubed and so forth, which are going to generally complicate things. So I think this is really a fairly useful result and applicable rather generally to the case of superconducting qubits. Okay, that was what I wanted to say today. Next time I'll at least start on the discussion of specific forms of superconducting qubit, if there are things that people would particularly like to hear about, tell me fairly soon, because I have to start writing lecture 10 fairly soon. What I thought, if I don't get any special requests, I thought what I'll do is in the next lecture I'll try to cover the basic forms of superconducting qubit, and then in lecture 10 I will go on and talk about some of the more advanced designs and the kinds of results which people have got and what kind of fidelities they've managed to get at, and things like that. And then in lecture 11 I'll talk about the specific case of trying to do an explicit test of quantum mechanics against macro-realistic theories, something I've been particularly interested in. And as I say, if I don't get any other requests, then I did get this one request, I don't know if anyone who's here now, to discuss Laughlin's recent work on high-temperature superconductivity, and I thought I might take lecture 12 to do that. But as I say, if other people want other things, tell me. Okay, any general questions, comments, suggestions? Well, you might, but then, yes, I think you probably could legitimately look at it that way. So if I've got a, if I've got an environment which is, suppose I've got simple ohmic dissipation, then I can indeed model it by this, this general scheme. And because I've got this coordinate-coordinate coupling in there, that's saying in some qualitative sense the environment is trying to observe the value of the Q, which is actually the variable trying to tunnel. So yes, so that would mean it would slow down the tunneling rate. If on the other hand, I can have a situation where the natural, we can put it in this language, but a more natural way to put it is the environment is coupled directly to P rather than Q. In other words, the interaction, I could now rewrite the interaction term as proportional to P rather than Q, then the environment is going to try to come in and observe the momentum. So that's going to narrow up the momentum spread and thereby increase the coordinate spread and thereby increase the tunneling rate. It does happen. It's an unusual case, but that's done. I go into that kind of question in some detail in a paper. I forget where I referenced it. Let me just take a look. It's a paper in PhysRev in 1984. I think it's probably there somewhere, is it? Yes, that's it there if you can read it. Hopefully it'll be readable in the printed notes anyway. Yeah, but I do in fact discuss this question of normal versus anomalous dissipation in some detail. Yeah. So all these things probably look pretty trivial today, but I can assure you they were a source of a fair amount of heated controversy in the early 80s. I think that would depend a lot on the particular physical configuration you were thinking about. Let's put it this way: tunneling is one example of the consequences of a spreading of the phase or the flux or whatever. Let's say the phase. In fact, if the phase if the phase could undergo arbitrary large fluctuations, then of course the standard description of bulk superconductivity wouldn't work. I mean, we believe, in fact, many people believe that's what happens in the high temperature, the cuprate superconductors in the so-called pseudo-gap region of the phase diagram. People believe that although Cooper pairs are in some sense formed there, nevertheless the phase of the centre of mass order parameter is fluctuating so strongly that you don't get the kind of long-range order you need for superconductivity. So to that extent, I think, say that. Okay, I'll see you then on Thursday.